I'm Frederick Dove. Welcome to Havering College and to Havering Asks 2016. A key aim today is to promote awareness among students here in Northeast London of topical developments and the value of discussing differences of opinion in our diverse society. Also importantly, the technical, organizational, and logistical challenges of this project help students here at Havering College develop their skills in areas such as live TV production and event management. Over the next hour, our panelists will answer questions from the audience and hopefully will also get the audience to respond to some of the answers they hear. If you're watching online via the live stream, you too can contribute via hashtag HaveringAsks. Let me introduce our guests. Hannah Clare is co-chair of the Young Greens and a campaigner for youth empowerment. She's from Essex and joined the Green Party while at university, where she also participated heavily in the debating circuit, and that experience might come in useful today. This is how Hannah describes herself on Twitter: cat mum, fan of feminism, the environment, and of Doctor Who. I mostly retweet because I can't come up with my own tweets, unquote. Lord Edward Foulkes has been a barrister since 1973 and a Conservative life peer in the House of Lords since 2010. In July, he resigned as Minister of State for Justice because Liz Truss, who has no professional legal background, had been made Lord Chancellor and Secretary of State for Justice. We may come back to that issue later. While at school, Edward had a rock band. But he may have mellowed somewhat since then because in legal circles, he's described as, and I quote, terribly calm and measured. In tense situations, he creates an atmosphere of calm and confidence, and he must be one of the most charming and polite men on the earth. I won't call, we'll find out. Now, Mike Gapes was born in Essex. He's a fanatical West Ham supporter, and believe me, I mean fanatical. He's been bending my ear about the club already before we started. He's been Labour MP for Ilford South since 1992. He did some volunteer teaching in Southern Africa before university and has travelled the world on parliamentary business. He is pro-EU membership, pro-Israel, but not, it appears, very pro-Jeremy Corbyn as Labour leader. In response to criticism from supporters of Mr. Corbyn, Mike once tweeted, "I'm not resigning. I'm Labour. If you want me out, you'll have to deselect me. I'm not going anywhere." Well, not in the next hour, we hope, anyway. Political and youth activist Gulwali Pasale comes from eastern Afghanistan. After his father was killed there, his mother paid people smugglers to get Gulwali and his older brother to Europe to avoid her sons being recruited by the Taliban. After a year of traveling through 10 countries, Gulwali arrived in the UK. He was 13, but British officials assessed him as being 16. He was eventually able to convince the Home Office of his real age. He went on to pass GCSEs, A-levels, and now has a degree from Manchester University. In 2012, he carried the Olympic torch as it passed through Burnley. And Gulwali has told his story in a book. It's called The Lightless Sky, an Afghan refugee boy's journey of escape to a new life in Britain. Ladies and gentlemen, our panel. And we shall now take our first question. It comes from Adam Bigu.
With President Trump in the White House, will the world be a more unstable place?
Thank you, Adam. And I should have said that Adam is a member of the Havering College Students' Union, so they are our hosts today. With President Trump in the White House, will the world be a more unstable place? Gulwali, I'm going to start with you. Afghanistan has had an interesting relationship with the United States, as we know, over the last 20 more years. Will President Trump make the world more unstable?
Great, thank you for your question. I think, yes, he would. I feel like he wouldn't have been, if Hillary Clinton was elected, it wouldn't have been much different either. But the difference is now we know what Trump is going to do, even though he's somewhat unpredictable. But at the same time, Clinton was nice from outside, but in theory, in terms of politics, in American foreign policy, and how things wouldn't change from much. I mean, we look at Bush and then Obama. Obama was this nice guy. I have so much respect for Obama, but then he increased drone attacks. He sent more troops to Afghanistan. So when it comes to the Afghan and the U.S. relationship, and when it comes to main foreign policy issues, I don't think much will change. But the rhetoric that Trump uses, such as banning Muslims and the things that he says about Mexicans and foreigners, is really distressing. It's really upsetting in 21st century. In 2016, we will have a presidential candidate, not only a presidential candidate, but somebody who is supposedly the leader of the free world, to say such things is a disgrace. And I think it's unfortunate that the American people has elected him. I mean, that's what democracy is, and he won. Now, I hope he will turn down his rhetorics, and he will be more understanding, because before that, he had no idea of what politics really is about. I mean, sometime he said himself, actually, that he wasn't aware what is involved being a president. So I hope that he will have a different policies than Afghanistan, for example, because so far in the last 50 years, I feel like the US strategy and policies in Afghanistan has been a great failure. We haven't achieved peace and stability. There has been more death and destruction. And Afghanistan is not a safe place. And millions, not millions, but 100,000 lives has been lost, fortunately.
Focusing on Afghanistan, Mr. Trump has made it quite clear he's only interested in American interests. If he were to kind of vastly reduce American involvement in Afghanistan, would you welcome that, or would that make Afghanistan a more unstable place than it is?
In my personal view, I think America in the West shouldn't have went to Afghanistan in the first place. I wouldn't have been made a refugee at the age of 12 if the Western intervention and involvement did not take place. However, I think Trump is not somebody who will basically be in charge completely of his foreign policy. I think the State Department, as well as Congress and Senate, because America has spent about a trillion pound or dollar in Afghanistan. So I will welcome the reduction in the involvement in Afghanistan, but I hope America and the West will continue to support Afghan forces in the Afghan government to achieve peace. I think having military on the ground doesn't really help. It doesn't solve the problem. It doesn't solve the militancy in insurgency. So one of the way we can bring stability in peace in Afghanistan is supporting development, education, infrastructure, and other projects which are basically Afghan-led, not a foreign-led or foreign kind of influenced in that way. So I will welcome any reduction in the US military policies in Afghanistan.
Edward Folks, on the wider global scale, how do you see these next 4 years under President Trump panning out?
Well, I don't really agree with Gilwali that we know what he's going to do. One of the problems is that we don't know what he's going to do. I'm not sure that he's terribly interested in foreign policy. He's very interested in America first. What matters to the American people is largely speaking what happens within America rather than outside America. He does, however, I suppose, have the advantage that it may be less likely that he's going to make interventions in other parts of the world where America's presence, to put it mildly, has not necessarily been welcomed. He has expressed admiration for Putin, which is somewhat alarming. On the other hand, it may be that this could calm things down between the West and Putin if he can maintain reasonably good relationships with them. As far as the United Kingdom's concerned, he has this rather strange relationship with the former leader of UKIP, who seems to have access to him, bypassing the normal channels. I mean, I hope that we can have a good relationship with Trump, but I think a number of people are going to have to eat their words, not least his potential Secretary of State, Mitt Romney, who during the campaign spent most of the time insulting him and vice versa, but now is busy having dinner with him and possibly being lined up to Secretary of State.
And is that perhaps a good sign that before an election, someone as senior as Mitt Romney can say some terribly critical things, but after the election maybe work together and get on with the job?
I think it must be a good sign. Anything like that must be a good sign. He needs friends. He needs expertise. One of the things I hope about him is that it's apparently true that he has a short attention span. Now, that sounds appalling in a president. However, it does mean, perhaps, that he will delegate to people who know what they're doing. I hope that he's able to do that effectively.
Talking of short attention spans, Anna, and I don't mean you have, but you're a big fan of Twitter, so is President Trump. So you've got something in common. I want to come on to perhaps President Trump's environmental impact in a bit later, perhaps. But in terms of just the world, how do you see the next 4 years under this rather surprising American president?
Yeah, I mean, I think the thing with the US is that they can sometimes lead the way and perhaps influence other countries in what they do. And, you know, I'm waking up the next morning, it was kind of a bit like feeling like the waking up after the EU referendum, really thinking, oh gosh, is this really a thing that's happened? And I'm really worried about the protection of minorities, particularly people of colour. And I'm obviously very worried about climate change, because you've got a climate denier who can't seem to grasp the fact that we are warming, and facts and statistics don't seem to be convincing him either way, and even the people around him as well. Mike Pence, for example, is pro-conversion therapy, which is a horrible practice, one which I hope happens nowhere.
Just explain what you mean by that, just in case people...
So conversion therapy is the idea that if you are gay, then you can have some therapy that says that you won't be gay anymore. And these practices will include torture, some so that in some practices where it's happened, people have actually died as a result of the torture. So it's a horrible, horrible thing. And the fact that that's even a thing that people do in this day and age just astounds me. And the fact that you've got, you know, the vice president of the United States thinking that's a good idea is horrific. And I think horrific is probably the way that sums up Trump in general. But what's quite interesting is that since he's been elected, he's getting this reputation as moderating. So he's saying slightly less extreme things that he was during the campaign, but yet he's then going and doing completely other thing and going the complete opposite way with his appointments. And I wonder if that's a sign of how he's going to behave in general.
So as Edward just said, not even he knows what he's going to do.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, Fidel Castro is very keen on conversion therapy as well. So there's a precedent for that.
Fidel Castro, the former Cuban leader.
Absolutely.
Who's just died.
Yeah.
And nobody really talks about that, which is...
No, but it's been revealed recently that was one of his particular peccadilloes in terms of what he thought was an enlightened approach to society. It's dreadful.
Mike Gapes, you've travelled widely on parliamentary business, as I mentioned earlier. How do you see globally the next 4 years panning out?
Well, I'm a member of the Parliamentary Assembly of NATO, which is the 28 NATO countries, members of parliament. We had a meeting 2 weekends ago, and the MPs from Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, the Baltic states are extremely nervous. Trump, a few months ago, described an area of Estonia as a suburb of St. Petersburg.
And just to explain, St.
Petersburg
is a Russian city.
City, and he also has said that Putin's invasion of the sovereign territory of Ukraine and the annexation of Crimea was not a big problem for him. He has said that Article 5 of NATO, which is the collective self-defense, should not apply if the Americans are paying disproportionately in, and that other countries should have to pay to get American support. Now, that basically undermines the whole basis of the security architecture.
Isn't he right to point out that being in NATO...
Article 5, I'm not talking about the spending figure of 2%, I'm talking about the commitment to collective security and defence. The Americans under Obama have been positioning troops, as we are in Britain, into Poland, Romania and the Baltic states to assist the security and the defence of those small, weak, very vulnerable countries on the borders of Russia. What we are likely to see is a Trump presidency which basically tries to do a big deal with Putin, and that's not necessarily good news for people who believe in democracy and freedom in Europe. It also is a big worry if you are in Syria at this moment, where the policy you see on the television screens, what's happening in Aleppo. Trump's attitude will be that America and Russia will do a deal and they won't be interested in human rights, he won't be interested in humanitarian things. I fear that we are moving into a world which is a very difficult one because of Trump. I'll just make one final remark. He's made a number of appointments already. Now, they have to be ratified in senior posts in the American system by the Senate. The advantage of the American system is that Trump will not be able to be a dictator. There is a separation of powers, the House of Representatives, the Senate. There's also a Supreme Court. He won't get it all his own way. But nevertheless, all his appointments so far indicate this is going to be a very, very difficult regime for us to deal with in the rest of the world, as well as internally for many, many Americans. And remember, the majority of Americans have voted for Hillary Clinton, not for Donald Trump. But the election system that they have means that he's got the majority in the college which chooses the president.
Completely, I agree with Mike what he's saying, but with due respect, I think Trump is, I'm not a big fan of Trump, but he is where he is because of the failure of politicians in politics in general. People, he appealed to the masses and he said, look, I'm going to offer something different. It's not going to be the same. It's going to be unique. It's going to be radical. And that's what he's doing. And I think, in my view, I think NATO is not really there for peace. I think putting troops on the Russian border doesn't reduce escalation. It increases escalations. We have to be talking to the Russians. We have to be having more diplomatic and political solution rather than sending militaries and troops on the border of Eastern Europe. That actually makes it more, that makes Russia more angry, saying, well, that goes against our national security.
The Russians invaded and occupied the territory of Georgia in 2008. Mm-hmm. The Russians invaded and occupied the territory of Ukraine in 2014. The Russians are taking a position under Putin in the last few years, which is aggressive and actually undermining the sovereignty of and the free choices democratically
but
of neighbouring countries.
We, I mean,
the whole purpose
the whole
of
world.
The collective security that we've had in Europe for the last 50, 60 years is to prevent war and mm-hmm. to prevent people trying to redraw maps by use of force. If Putin continues in this way, then what's there to protect small countries in Central and Eastern Europe? It is NATO which gives them that security. Ukraine's not in NATO, they were invaded. Georgia's not in NATO, they were invaded. And therefore there is a point here where we have collective obligations to each other. And frankly, if we allow Russia to carry on in this path, then we will get more and more of these problems on the borders of Europe.
We have to deal with the world as it is. And he has said that apart from the United Kingdom, people are not producing enough in terms of their contribution to the NATO budget.
I agree with that.
Do you not think he's got a point?
He has. He has. We are only, there are only five NATO countries, the UK is one of them, that meet the 2% figure as a percentage of GDP for defence. But at the end of the day, even if there is a fairer proportioning out, the Americans will still be significantly the largest contributor.
So those countries that are not coughing up their 2% as they're supposed to, if they now do, then there's no...
No, that's not what he said. He said that Article 5 of NATO should not necessarily apply. And that has caused doubt. Now, hopefully, when he gets his new defence secretary and his new administration in January, because he's not president yet,
he knows what is in Article 5?
Probably not. But the point is, there's many things I'm sure he hasn't read. Yeah. But if you are about to become leader of a country and you start making statements of that kind, then other countries notice that. And then they are unhappy. Yeah. And my point is that the countries in Central and Eastern Europe are very worried about what this means.
Let me just come to a point that we sort of harked at. Again, it's in connection with the Trump presidency. It's the environmental side, which, of course, concerns everybody around the globe. Benjamin Francis of Havering College has a question on that side. If we can just get a mic to Benjamin. Hang on a sec. Here we go. Benjamin, your question.
What impact could the Trump presidency have on the environmental protection?
Okay, Claire, you hinted at it. Anna. Now, global, climate change, there is a dispute. Some disagree, some think it's man-made. Donald Trump is definitely on one side of the argument as far as we can tell. So what's going to happen over the next 4 years to that?
I mean, the thing about climate change is that it doesn't stop at a border. You know, we all have to do our part to stop climate change. And, you know, I think there's a lot to be said about greenwashing in our government. But when you've got someone so vehemently against the idea that climate change is even a problem, then, you know, we're going to have a big, big problem. Because 2016 is the hottest year since records began in 1880. Four of the hottest years since record have happened in the last 10 years. Now, if that's not a signal that something's absolutely wrong, then I don't know what is. And if, you do need governments across the world actually looking at what they're doing and realising that we need a drastic change in how we're operating. And he's just not going to deliver that. And I, that's one of my main concerns.
So should the world just carry on without him and without the United States? Because after all, you know, if everybody's in the same boat, the United States, although a big polluter, are not the only ones.
Yeah, I mean, even China have started to realise that they need to take this drastic action. You know, we need to do something. And you can't. I think as the UK, we should be a world leader in stopping climate change, because ultimately we've contributed, and we do contribute more than anyone else. And so, we should continue without him. But I hope that everyone else taking action will make him sort of follow suit.
Gulwali, and obviously for Afghanistan, you know, it environmental change may not be the most important thing at the moment, but as Hannah just said, pollution doesn't stop at a border. So, President Trump in the White House, will it have an impact on the global climate or how we try and protect it?
I think certainly. I think there's a saying that when America sneezes, the world catches the cold. And I think because people look at America as an example, although it has its faults, it has its problems.
But for Afghanistan, sorry to interrupt, but as Hannah just mentioned, for Afghanistan, it's perhaps more important what India and China are doing, and they're big polluters too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. I mean, Kabul, the capital city of Afghanistan, is struggling with pollutions, and even across Afghanistan, although we don't pollute as much, but because of the neighbors that we have who are developing economies do. So the point is not, as this says, it's not about borders, it's about the whole world. And I think Trump is very extreme in his views on climate change, and he thinks, you know, it costs American jobs, it costs the economy, and I fear actually he will go against the Paris Agreement, and he will not accept.
Which says what?
Which says that the Paris Agreement says almost all of the world came together, the countries, to agree on reducing carbon dioxide, reducing pollutions, and making the world, reducing, basically working on climate change and global warming. So that's something, a really big stepping stone in going forward and making sure currently agrees. Even China and America and countries who are historically was not really keen were joining in. But if America falls out, a lot of other countries will have a good excuse to say, well, we're not going to do it. If the US is not doing it, it's the biggest polluter, why should we? Smaller countries especially.
Again, just staying with Trump, one more kind of supplementary on this, because after all, this is Britain. So Angelina Sera of the Oaks Park School has a question that kind of talks about Britain's relationship with Mr. Trump.
How do you think the election of President-elect Donald Trump will affect the trading links between Britain and the USA?
So will the next 4 years see any change in the trading links between Britain and the USA? And we're not really going to talk about Brexit. I suspect that will come up later. But Edward, in terms of the United States under Donald Trump and Britain, will there be a change?
Well, if you remember, when President Obama came over, he said that we would be last in the queue if we left the EU. Sorry to bring in Brexit, but no. It's kind of relevant to the question. Whereas the noises, at least, coming from President Trump are that we wouldn't necessarily be last in the queue. But like everything else he said during the run-up to his election, I'm not sure that we should be totally relaxed or reliant upon what he says. Equally, I think that goes the other way, just briefly to go back to what Hannah said. I don't think one man can stop this momentum, actually, in terms of dealing with climate change. There is such an overwhelming degree of support worldwide, and the science is so clear that I think he will look increasingly ridiculous if he stops.
Do
that.
You think he can be shamed into kind of adopting a global position?
I'm not sure shamed is going to be quite the word.
Persuaded.
But I think he will eventually have to give way to the overwhelming consensus that really exists in this sphere. Do I think our relationship with in trading relationship? I simply don't know, and perhaps other members of the panel feel confident about that. I don't, but I mean, it is at least possible, and let's hope it can.
Is there still a special relationship between London and Washington?
The special relationship, much talked about, it's often felt that we think it's a special relationship, but the United States doesn't think it's a special relationship. Certainly when they come over here, presidents always reiterate that it is a special relationship. And of course, we have this shared history, particularly with the Second World War, a common language. There are huge links between our countries. I hope that we'll be able to maintain relations. As for trading, I think it's all very much in the air.
Mike, trading links?
US? I agree. I actually agree with Edward. I think the first thing to remember is that we can't negotiate separate deals with other countries whilst we are still in the European Union, and we are still in the European Union, and we will be for at least 2.5 years. and there may well then have to be transitional arrangements which could take it longer. The second point is that 40% plus of our trade goes to Europe. That is our main trading partner, and we need to recognise that. We don't want to put that in jeopardy.
Do you know how much a percentage it is with the United States?
Off the top of my head, I think it's about 10.
So about a quarter,
there, but
maybe.
I'm not sure it's...
But significantly less.
It is, yeah, it's more to Europe collectively than to the US. We sell more to Ireland and the Netherlands than we do to China. But the other point that I want to comment on is this thing about the climate change process. The Paris Agreement is very important. China and President Obama played a big role in getting that. It's one of Obama's main achievements that he did get the Americans to sign up to it. There was always going to be a problem with the ratification in the nature of the American political system. But I don't think Trump's going to pull America off it. I think it's more likely that there'll be no attempt to ratify in the American Congress, and also that there won't be any real measures taken, because the agreement is an in principle about what you should do. It doesn't have sanctions if you don't do things. The rest of the world will go ahead with Paris because it's in our interests. And the world's population is growing, and the demand for energy is growing, and we've got to make sure we cap the levels of carbon, otherwise temperatures go up, the sea levels rise, countries like Bangladesh go under the water, and we've really got to urgently look at this.
We're going to go to a break shortly, but I've just got time to just squeeze in a question on a very different topic. It comes from Nojas Janpolskis from the Oaks Park School. If we can just get a microphone to Yanis. Noise. This is about university, so hopefully of interest to the audience here. Noise.
Is it acceptable that university fees are going up again?
Now, as we remember, huge hoo-ha when the university fees went up to £9,000. Now they're going to go up again. Edward Foulkes.
Well, I expect most of you would say there shouldn't be university fees at all. I mean, there is an argument to that effect. Jeremy Corbyn has said that he's going to abolish them. I don't think it's part of Labour Party policy yet, but it's going to be part of overall taxation. Andy Burnham, I think, said in his leadership campaign that it was going to be a question of a graduate tax, although that's difficult because once you've graduated, you may leave the country, it may be difficult to collect. The general consensus, believe it or not, between the parties, the Liberal Democrats accepted, and we won't intrude on private grief there, was that there should be tuition fees because it was an extremely expensive question of educating people. And on the whole, going to university or further education does result in your getting a benefit. The student loan is paid back only if you reach a certain level. I think the reason that they're going to be increased, so Joe Johnson, who's the Minister for Education, says, is that we need to tie it to excellence in teaching. We have to ensure that the qualities are maintained. Frankly, it's a hardship for anybody to have to pay more. I entirely accept. But the principle that that should be paid for and paid back gradually over a long period, I think, is probably inevitable. Unfortunate and hard, though, it can be from time to time.
Just briefly, Gowali, because you've just graduated from the University of Manchester, and congratulations about
Thank
that.
You.
But should people pay even more?
Great. Well, I never imagined graduating and even going to uni in the first place. For me, I appreciate education. I know how important it is. I think education should be a public good. I think countries where they don't charge tuition fees, more students go to university, more people are educated, more people are skilled. I think in the UK, although we are one of the best in the world, our universities is some of the best in the world for education and educating leaders in people from across the world. I don't mind having some sort of fee, but I think, I mean, 9,000 is quite a lot. And making it more than that is will be not only unfair, but it will be really demoralizing. The fact I finished university 3 years, now I'm in £45,000 debt. That feelings, that have just knowing that, you know, it's not, even though I don't have to pay it now, I probably pay it in the future, but still having that guilt kind of feeling, is though I'm in debt. I have an education, but it didn't just came to me in I am not even.
Do you not see it more as a graduate tax? Do you think of it more as a borrowed money?
I feel like it's a burden, and a lot of students do this in the same way. They see it as a burden on them, even though they're not paying it straight away, or they're not being asked for it, but still it's an uneasy feeling.
We're going to take a break now, but do join us again in a couple of minutes. Welcome back to the second part of Havering Asks 2016. I'm Frederick Dove, and with me here at Havering College is a panel of guests answering questions from an audience of local students. And we're now going to take our next question, and perhaps it's no great surprise what the topic is going to be. The question comes from Mia Oluwaju of the Oaks Park School. Mia.
Will the UK's future be brighter outside the EU?
Will the UK's future be brighter outside the EU? Hannah?
No.
Mike? No, okay, carry on.
I was pro-Remain in the referendum. I think that, you know, the great benefit of the EU was about cooperation, and that was why it was formed, and it's a shame that we've, well, I mean, as a young person, certainly I feel quite upset that a group of older people have almost taken away my future from me. I think we are better in the EU. I think the benefit of being able to cooperate on that level was really key for us. And I think, you know, there was a lot of lies put out in the campaign. And, you know, we've got to move on. And I hope that whatever the agreement is, it protects migrants in this country, and that it ensures that, you know, we're not going to be so hard done by. But you saw the autumn statement last week, and, you know, it seems that even economically we're not doing so well as a result.
Edward Fox.
Yeah, we have got to move on. I voted to remain, but I do resent the fact that a number of people who had the same view as me ultimately are rather dismissive of the majority of the people, small majority though it may have been, who voted to leave the European Union. I wanted to remain, but there were some good reasons why you should vote or should have voted to leave the European Union. It had probably exceeded its original aim. We had got rather a special deal, it has to be said, not being involved in the euro, not being involved in Schengen. But there was the crushing weight of the European Court of Justice, the fact that freedom of movement originally for a small group of countries meant that we were suddenly unable to control the influx of immigrants. There were some people who had proper reasons, a lot of them living around here, as to why we should leave. Now, the future is uncertain, frankly. I'm worried, but I hope I'm wrong. The initial disaster financially, which was predicted by George Osborne in his scare budget, has not in fact materialized. Although the pound has dropped, a number of other economic indicators have not been that unfavorable. We're a gutsy country. We've survived many things. I think we'll survive this. It's just going to be a rocky road on the way to doing so.
So eventually you think it might have been worth it?
I hope so.
Now, Mike Gibbs, I suspect I know your answer, but could there be a brighter future at the end of the next few years of turbulence?
I am very worried. I share Hannah's view, but I also think we have to recognise we haven't left the European Union yet. The economic disaster hasn't happened yet, because we're still in the single market. If we go over the cliff and we don't get an agreement in the 2 years of the negotiations, which will start, the Prime Minister says, by the end of March next year, I fear that we will be in a very difficult position. The autumn statement last week, the government has already conceded that growth is going to fall to 1.4%. It was predicted at about 2.5% a year, but it's going to fall. The deficit is now going to be £122 billion, £60 billion of that directly attributable to the consequences of the vote taken in June. We are going to be worse off for several years. The fall in the value of the pound will mean higher prices, higher inflation, because we import a lot of goods that we consume.
Yeah, but doesn't it help exports?
It does help exports, but it doesn't help people who have had their real living standards frozen for several years. And most people in this country are feeling the pinch, and they were angry. That's why there was a vote of 52 to 48. But remember, it's only a narrow vote in a referendum at a particular time, which constitutionally is an advisory referendum. My job as a Member of Parliament is to mitigate the damage. And I am not going to vote for the triggering of Article 50 until the government brings forward a plan as to what it's going to do to deal with the consequences of that.
So you think you have a veto?
I do not have a veto, because ultimately we live in a parliamentary democracy. But I personally will represent my constituents who voted to remain, and I will represent the national interests of my country. And I believe that as long as we remain in a parliamentary democracy, it's the responsibility of members of parliament not to vote for people to be worse off. The Chancellor of the Exchequer, Philip Hammond, before the referendum said this is not about people voting to make themselves worse off. If we judge that if this was something that is going to make us worse off, then
why did your party not oppose a referendum then?
I want to say to you very bluntly, I did oppose a referendum. I campaigned, I put amendments to the private members' bills before the general election.
Your party
won the election, mm-hmm. Therefore you had a mandate to bring in the referendum. But that doesn't mean, just as Nigel Farage said, if it was 52-48 to stay in, he was not going to accept it. I don't see why the 48% of us should just roll over and have a hard Brexit. We should get as close as possible to the EU in terms of the single market. We should have continuing defence and security cooperation. We should have continuing anti-terrorism and policing cooperation. And we should work politically, even outside the EU, with other European countries, just like Norway does today with the EU, just like Switzerland does. That is our future, because geographically we are still Europeans.
I'll come to you in a moment, Gulwali, because I want your perspective, because there's probably kind of an interesting take on that. I'm just going to go out on a limb a little bit, because it is a very sensitive question. People have lost friendships over this, I know that. But I would be very interested, here in the hall, where I imagine that members of the audience were not able, because of their age, to vote in the referendum in June. But is anybody in this room willing to put their hand up and say that they are absolutely delighted with the way that the vote went? Is anybody willing to put their hand up? I know it's a sensitive issue. Just because you don't put your hand up doesn't mean you're not. But I understand that there are one or two hands willing to go up. By definition, I guess, if I say how many people were, shall we say, disappointed with the result in June, would you put your hands up? More hands, obviously. It's a very sensitive. I'm not going to come to anybody, because I don't want you to have rolling discussions and arguments on a Friday night in Havering after this Havering Asks session is over. But generally, more hands against the result than for. But as I say, it's a 16 to 17 year old audience. That's very telling. But you weren't allowed to vote. Now, Gulwali, you've been in this country for many years, so obviously you've followed all this, but you've got that added perspective from the... How do you see this referendum that happened in Britain in June? What was your take on it?
I think in my view, I was certain that we were going to vote to stay because I thought the implications and the consequences of leaving will be huge. But I underestimated the British people. I think majority of the people who voted leave did it in a good faith, but there were others who were misled and lied to by people like Nigel Farage and the UKIP and other right wing who wanted to basically take control back. And then now doesn't anyone want the UK Parliament to vote on it? They wanted control back for the UK Parliament. Now they don't want that as well. The funny thing is the UK wanted to have a relationship with Europe like the Norwegian model or the Swiss model. Actually, Norway and Switzerland pay a lot of money to Europe and doesn't have a say. They're not around the table. And Britain will not become like them because the European Union, in my view, will teach them a lesson. So other countries will not want to leave. And this is the first time that a country wanted to leave the European Union. A lot of countries like Turkey and others and former Yugoslavia who wants to join them. So in my view, I think it's still not too late. We made a huge mistake. The people or the government, I mean, there was no need for a referendum. I mean, as again, Meg said, it's an advisory vote. Yes, there were huge feelings. It's a sensitive topic. Now we see probably 15% of the consequences. We haven't seen the full scale of it. It's still not too late. We should either have a second referendum.
It's an advisory vote.
It is, indeed.
Do you think that the government could have said, if it had gone the other way, would say, well, thank you very much, you've all voted to stay in the European Union. We've had your advice, but actually we're going to leave.
No. Well, actually, they could have consulted the Parliament. Parliament is sovereign. Parliament should have the last say, saying, OK, we heard your views, but this is our perspectives, and now we make a decision, and let Parliament debate this, and let Parliament have a say. And
What's the point in having a referendum at all, then, if your
Parliament
decides?
That's the whole point. Advisory, it's a consultation you have with the people.
Well, and like a sort of poll or something.
Yeah, that's what it is. Either you change the constitution or you bring an amendment to the parliamentary act which says you can have a referendum and say, look, it's binding. If you have a referendum, then therefore that's not advisory. So my view is I think it's still not too late. We either have a second referendum, we either have a general election, or thirdly, let Parliament decide. Whichever way Parliament should be free to vote whichever way it feels like they should vote.
So Parliament can ignore the referendum?
I think if it's in the best interest of the people, they should.
Mike.
Yeah, the question on the ballot paper was not, do you wish to remain in the single market? Do you wish to remain in a security relationship or foreign policy? It was a simple question, do you wish to stay or leave? But it didn't actually spell out what the detail was. Mm-hmm. And we had the lying bus, the £350 million red bus. You remember that? And then we had the leaflet saying, if you vote to stay, 75 million Turkish people will come into your country next week. And all this stuff, which... The real issue is that the Leave side never spelt out what the actual process was going to be. They probably didn't expect to win, which is the truth. And the Remain side thought that we were rerunning the Scottish referendum where frightening people about the consequences would be sufficient. So we didn't put any positive vision. It was a terrible campaign. But Parliament now has to deal with the consequences of this and look at what Leave means. We've got 40 years of legislation which is enmeshed with European Union. And we've got to try and find a way to disentangle all this. It's going to take years
and
years.
It's all unnecessary. Why are we doing this? Why are we putting ourselves in such a mess? And also, people didn't realise the outcome. Look at Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland. They have a land border. What are we coming to? And look at... We are leaving the European Union. Next year, you will see Scotland leave the UK, for example, and join the European Union.
No.
It'll just become so
very
crazy.
Unlikely.
It's not going to happen.
Before we get dragged,
I think
it did.
That's not going to happen.
We have an arm up in the audience. So let me. Noyes, you asked a question earlier, but you want to make a point here.
Yeah, I want to go back to when it was said that if we had voted to stay, the Parliament could have just said we should leave. And I think that's a very interesting point because, for instance, with the Heathrow airports, that's been taking loads of years to for them to decide whether they should build them, and for the to leave EU, they want to do it in 2 years, and they know the implications, and most people in Parliament were against Brexit, but now after the voting, they just decide it was a close vote, and they decided that they would leave it and leave it as soon as possible.
So you think it's being made too quickly, the decision?
And I think it might even be a bit subjective.
Let me try another quick straw poll here. And again, I'm not going to ask you how you would vote. But if there were, in say, not next year, the year after, when I suspect many of you would be able to vote, If there were a second referendum, would you vote? Just stick your hand up if you would vote. Not just if you would be willing to go to the... Doesn't matter what you vote. Would you go and make sure your vote was counted? Still only less than half, so...
Can I just make a point?
Yes, go on.
I think, you know, I've been here in the UK for about 10 years, and I live here as a refugee, and I'm able to do anything as a normal citizen except vote, because it's a privilege for those who have nationality and who are citizens. And it makes me really upset and angry, actually, people who are able to vote and doesn't vote. There are millions of people across the world who would love to have the right to vote and have a say and have a voice. Let's utilize it. Let's use it. Encourage your friends if there's a general election, not only in elections, but generally be involved in politics, be active in charities, for example, pressure group, political parties, whatever not. And just a final point about the referendum. One of the biggest problems with the referendum I had was not allowing 16 years old to vote, because it is about the future of young people. It's the future of this country. And not allowing, like in the Scottish referendum, not allowing 16 and 17 years to vote was a big mistake by the parts of government and by the parts of our parliament. I think that should have happened, and the result would have been completely different. Why should old people, 80 plus, 90 plus, decide the future of this country and your future?
Now, obviously, during the referendum campaign, immigration was a huge topic, both from within the European Union and from outside the European Union. Charlie Miller, a student here at Havering College, has a question on that topic. Charlie.
Should the UK allow in more refugees?
Should the UK allow in more refugees? Now, Gawani, I'm sure you've got something to say, but I'll come to you a little bit later. Mike Gapes first.
I think it's very important to make the difference between immigration and refugees. Sure. Refugees are people who are fleeing from threats to their lives, of persecution, and there is an international convention, by law, that all countries are supposed to respect and provide sanctuary for people who are fleeing because of persecution. Most refugees go to their next door country. There are millions of Syrian refugees, for example. There are 11 million people in Syria who have been driven out of their homes. There are 4 or 5 million of them out of the country in other countries, most of them in Turkey, in Jordan, in Lebanon, Iraq, next to Syria. Yet some of them, after years in those refugee camps, see no future, and they want to get a better life. Others, because they need to have sanctuary, try to come to Europe. Most people who come to Europe from Syria, for example, are going to Germany. Many are going to Sweden. We don't take many from Syria. We take very, very few. And I believe there is an argument we could take more Syrians. We could also take more people who are fleeing conflicts and from hardship and persecution.
Following
in other
the referendum
parts of the world.
Vote in June, Mike, will that happen?
I don't know. That depends upon whether the government has the courage to confront this issue and to emphasise the distinction between refugees, which is what the question was about, mm-hmm. and immigration. People who come here to work or to study or by virtue of marriage, or because they are dependents, children of people who are coming, who settled here, is a different question. And that is very important that we don't mix the two up, because people who are fleeing from civil wars or conflicts or persecution have to have sanctuary. And it's not right that very poor countries, which are like Lebanon or Iraq, next door to Syria, take the vast bulk of these people. We in the richer parts of the world also have to take a share. That's what sharing the burden is about. And I think we have a responsibility, as other European countries do as well.
Anna Claire?
Yeah, I think the government makes a lot of atrocious decisions, but I think our inaction on taking more refugees is probably one of the worst. If you ever see the pictures from the camps in Calais, I cannot believe that should ever happen, that there are people who are just being put in tents and just left there because we're being led by the right-wing press that says, you know, we don't, and Mike's right that we're getting immigration and refugees confused, and it's atrocious that we are not doing our thing, because often these situations are led and caused by are horrible foreign policy.
But if somebody, if somebody is fleeing war and wants peace, why do they not claim asylum in France when they're already there? Why do they have to go further? Why could they have not done it
people
in Italy, Greece?
People have their families in the UK. People, we shouldn't question where they want to go. We should just take them because they, and it's, you know, it's not just war refugees as well. I think that there's going to be a lot more climate migration in the future. And I think that we need to help people who are asking for it. And it's shameful. And I feel ashamed to be British saying that we are not doing enough.
But if sticking with the climate migration thing, you know, the running out of water, the rising of temperatures, there is no way that Europe can take the population of Northern Africa, for example.
No, but perhaps we, like, no matter the situation, I do think we need to help and we need to stop burying our heads in the sand over this. If it's climate migration, if it's migration, if it's refugees from war, sorry, then we need to ensure that we are doing something and we are not doing enough.
Gulwali.
I think it's a topic that is very close to my heart. I actually written a book about it. I made the journey from Afghanistan to Britain at the age of 12. And this point about why not claiming asylum in France, I went through 10 countries. I was unwelcome. Forget being treated as a human. I wasn't even treated as a child. Forget being treated as a child. I wasn't even treated as a human. I was imprisoned in almost every country except Italy, where I was treated kindly and nicely with humanity. And the issue is people come here because they have reason either to reunite with their families, or they think Britain is, or they have cultural language or historical links to Britain. Others think because they will be treated fairly, justly, and equally compared to the rest of half of the world. That is something we should be proud of. Of course, when you get here, it's not the exact. And I think we should definitely do more. Taking in people doesn't solve the problem. We should be doing more in ending conflicts, in ending wars. People are running away from persecutions, wars, and the worst crimes that you can imagine from Afghanistan, from Iraq, from Syria. And one of the biggest problems I have in the West, particularly with Britain, is the not lack of solidarity with Afghans in Afghanistan. We bombed Afghanistan. We were still kind of there. We were there. 500 British soldiers lost their lives, 2,000 wounded, $40 billion spent for what? For whom? Afghanistan is not safe. Yes, there are girls are going to education, girls are going to school, great. There are infrastructure and development, but at the same time, the mission is not accomplished. It has not made a difference, which it should have. The main point I want to make is that refugees are human like us. Nobody is born as a refugee. People become refugee out of circumstances. And nobody will be stupid to risk their lives and come all the way to Britain or to Europe to claim asylum to be safe. I hear these arguments about people are coming here for benefits, people are coming here for work. Even though, I mean, with my refugees, that's not the case. Refugees will be happy to stay, whatever. Lebanon, 1 in 4 people there are Syrian refugees.
A quarter of the population.
Exactly. The top 10 countries who are hosting refugees are developing countries who are poor. Sure. And 1 in 10 people are in Europe. So we don't. I'm glad the language that Mike used, because politicians doesn't use responsible language. They have to explain to their public, look, there's a difference between economic migrants, there's a difference between refugees, but of course we shouldn't brush everyone with the same brush saying, oh, everyone is an economic migrant. Using the right language, people are sympathetic. The British public wants to show solidarity. They came out on the street many, many times every year to say, look, refugees are welcome. But the government is not utilizing on people's goodwill. There's lack of political will to take action. Britain should be working with the European Union. I'm glad Calais is closed. Calais was the most miserable place that I have ever been in. And I think we should be able to work with the rest of the world, lead in this humanitarian crisis, and make an end to wars and conflicts, and play our part. Not only is it our moral duty in legal obligation, but we owe it to the world in some way or another to welcome those people and give them hope. But at the same time, they will be people who will contribute and make a difference and make our society better. So it's not a one-sided argument. And again, Britain is 23rd in the world for taking in refugees, and there are very few refugees in Britain compared to the rest of the world and compared to France, even in Germany, in Sweden, and other European countries. Let's do our part. Let's play what we can to reduce the suffering and pain of those people who are fleeing the worst crimes of humanity.
Edward Fox.
Yeah. I've got not much to add. Mike's, of course, right that there is a distinction between refugees and immigrants. And the problem is that these lines are not always quite as bright as we would like them to be. And it's all very well saying somebody falls into one category or another. There may be a number of different, perfectly understandable motives why somebody wants to come to this country.
But why is your party not taking more action? Why are they drawing arbitrary numbers and not doing something about this problem?
the government, whatever colour, has to go with what they think is practical in terms of processing people, because we are talking about people, dealing with them in a humanitarian way.
Mm-hmm. But it's not about practicality, it's about lives.
Well, it is quite a lot to do with practicalities. The Home Office is very keen that when people come here, they are properly looked after. Simply allowing them, as it were, across the channel to fend for themselves is not a good idea. We want to make sure there is the proper infrastructure ready for them. I agree that it's frustrating that there hasn't been more done more quickly. But I think we mustn't simply react emotionally to this. We have to have a rational approach. Of course, it's an emotional problem. Mm. But on the other hand,
4,000 people were killed last year in the Mediterranean because the UK stopped its rescue operation because it thought, you know, it encourages people to come here. Like the European power used to fought over the sea. Now it's letting people drown because they don't have the same value. They're not born here. It's about the otherness, the fear of the other, the indifference. It's not about, if we were treating them as human, we would be rescuing people in the Mediterranean. We would be cutting, we would be having people come here safely through a simple, safe legal route. Well, number, it's hard. I think we should play our fair share.
Well, you see, the trouble is, once you start talking about, you know, almost limitless numbers
of
whatever
category,
I mean, and with climate change, you're quite right. There is going to be more and more migration over the years. We are, I know it's a crude analogy, we are animals, effectively. We go to where the sources of wealth are, and it's natural that human beings should do that. It's going to happen more and more, and it's going to be very difficult to have a rational policy about this.
That's why we need to do more to make the world a just and equal place for everyone.
We're going to do a U-turn here from going from something very serious, because we've just got a little bit of time, to something incredibly trivial. I'm going to ask a question, because we just need fairly short answers on this. I don't expect them to be terribly serious. Which politician would you like to see on Strictly Come Dancing, and why? I'm going to come to the Labour MP last, because we all know about Ed Balls. Gulwali, have you been following Strictly?
I not really, but the only reason I've been is because of Ed Balls, and I think...
Haven't we all?
I think the politician I would really like to see there would be David Cameron.
David Cameron?
Yeah, I think it would be a really good combination, and it would work
well.
What
kind of dance would you like to see him do?
I don't really know about dance moves, but I think maybe in a competition with Ed Balls.
I mean, he's been dancing around a lot of subjects for a number of years.
Exactly, yeah.
Edward Foulkes, which politician would you like? I'm sure some of your colleagues in the House.
It's very, very important to be light on your feet in politics. Yeah. And I think...
Quick
stepping indeed. I think the Prime Minister, with her fondness for shoes, would make a good contestant. And I think they might be able to do some good work on her posture. Although she's an elegant lady, she doesn't stand beautifully. And I'm sure once those judges had really got to her, she would stand more beautifully when she entered Downing Street and went
I know this is perhaps inappropriate, but can I just say that I have been on the same dance floor as Theresa May many years ago.
Room for improvement?
It was some kind of benefit function. She was next to me and her bottom rubbed up against me. But we'll move on very quickly to Hannah.
So in the Green Party, we recently elected our new co-leaders. And one of them, I won't say which, has a great enjoyment of karaoke.
Caroline Lucas.
Yeah. And I think that either of them would be quite good on Strictly, actually, having seen them at conference.
And a Green Party co-leader would do what dance?
I don't know.
Is there an ecologically sound dance that you can think of?
One that doesn't involve a lot
something,
of light,
something
maybe?
Perhaps with a sort of jungle undertone, something
a lot
green.
A lot of energy, naturally, yeah. I thought. Charleston.
Maybe we need to find a way to harvest that energy.
Very good. Now, Mike, I obviously left you last because your party colleague, Ed Balls, has been the talk of the year on Strictly, made new fan. If he goes back into politics, I think the Labour Party fortunes could be very interesting anyway. Who would you like to see on the Strictly dance floor and why, among your political colleagues?
Well, I think I need to be fair to other parties, and so I'm not going to nominate a Labour politician.
Is that because you want someone else to be humiliated?
I want somebody else to be voted off immediately, even before they've danced. So I would propose Mr. Farage be put on so that people could vote him out straight away.
Very good.
May I suggest the hokey cokey, in, out, in, out?
No, in his case, out, out, out.
I'm not quite sure who would be leading in those parts. He keeps changing his mind.
And as a partner for Mr. Farage, could a dishy blonde, I'm thinking Donald Trump.
That would work well.
Any quick suggestions? Any politicians you'd like to see on the Strictly? I mean, I'm not sure any of you watch Strictly, of course. It's probably more a question of Honey G on the X Factor, but Let's not go there today.
Well, no, more people watch Planet Earth. More young people watch Planet Earth than they've watched X Factor recently. So
anybody here watch Planet Earth? Very, rather than X Factor. Now that is encouraging. Good. Good. Well, that brings us to an interesting end. Honey G, X Factor, Planet Earth. We're going to end there today. Thank you all very much indeed. I'm going to, of course, thank my panel. Mike Gapes, Labour MP, Gulwali Pasale, political youth activist, Hannah Clare, co-chair of the Young Greens, and Edward Folkes, Conservative member of the House of Lords and passionate cricketer. I'll throw that in at that point. My thanks, of course, to the team here, who worked so hard to make this happen. Thank you also, of course, to the audience, both here in the hall and on the live stream. Thank you to everyone who's tweeted in comments and questions during the past hour. Apologies for not getting them in. An hour is incredibly brief when you're sitting up here. And my own personal thanks to everyone at Havering College. It's been great to be back. Do join us again next year. From me, Frederick Duff, and everyone at Havering Asks 2016, goodbye.